So for the first time in forever, the Buckeyes will not cover the spread this week. They've got a bye week, and of course, coming off their biggest win of the season, thrashing Wisconsin at home 38-7. Talking Ohio State football, we got Patrick Murphy on the line from Bucknuts 247 Sports. Pat, how you doing today?
I'm good. How are you?
I am doing just fine. Appreciate you stopping by. Talking Buckeyes, even in a bye week, it's good to catch up with the number one team in the nation. I don't know. I think that they're certainly playing like it. I'm still ranking LSU number one based on resume, but in regards to complete domination and just looking airtight on every level, both sides of the football, plus the special teams, they're playing like the best team in America.
Yeah, it's tough to argue. Like you said, LSU, just based on their schedule and the ranked wins they have, you know, it's hard to match that resume. But if you're just looking on paper, what Ohio State's done, you know, the way they've controlled these games, they've won every game by 24 points or more, including last week's game against then number 13 Wisconsin. I mean, you know, they're certainly in that conversation with LSU, with Alabama. The first college football playoff rankings will come out next week, so it'll be very interesting to see, you know, not only how the rankings play out, but what the committee's, you know, looking at this year. Obviously, each year it changes a little bit with some new blood in there and just kind of the perspective that each person has. So it'll be interesting to see what they're valuing, whether, you know, it's the resume that LSU has, whether it's that game control that they've talked about a lot in previous years that Ohio State clearly checks all the boxes in, or, you know, what their criteria will be this year. I think we know for certain, you know, what the top four will be, especially after Oklahoma's loss. You can kind of play that out. But yeah, it'll be interesting just to see where each of the pieces fall. And then, you know, with the one loss teams in the country too, how close are they to that top four that everyone wants to be a part of? So I'm interested to see that. But Ohio State certainly in the mix. I would be surprised if they're not one or two, maybe three, if the committee is really valuing what Alabama's done. But to me, they're either the first or second team in the country.
You watch this team and then compare it against what we've seen in the Big Ten Eastern Division, and not to take anything away from Penn State, because certainly they have shown to be one of the 10 best teams in the country. But I think Ohio State's play has been, I won't say significantly better, I'll say decidedly better than Penn State. And they have a bit of a gap in regards to talent, elite talent, over what Penn State has on the roster. But again, Penn State, top 10 talent in the nation. You wonder, in looking at Ohio State's run, what could possibly go wrong? And then you see Justin Fields sprint toward the end zone against Wisconsin. You see him get upended. You see him hit his back, land on his back. And then a little bit later in the game, he got toppled after he made a spin move just a couple series later. Same thing happened. You could see him wincing. He's getting a little bit of treatment on the back. And that's the one big issue, potentially, if he would ever leave for an extended period of time.
Absolutely. Ohio State's got depth in almost every position. They do a lot of rotation, even somewhat on the offensive line, which is a group you don't see. The only exception to that is at quarterback, where Tate Martell, Matthew Baldwin both transferred out after Justin Fields transferred in this offseason. So they're down to Chris Chuganoff, who played at West Virginia. He came in actually in this game for a play early on because Justin Fields' helmet came off. And then Matthew Baldwin, who transferred from Gunnar Hoke, who transferred from Kentucky. Both fine players in their own right, but certainly not the dynamic player that Justin Fields is. If Fields has to miss any time, you know, if that back injury, say, was something that was going to bug him more than it did in this game, obviously he came back after going to the medical tent for a minute. You know, the Buckeyes might be in trouble offensively. They've got a lot of offensive talent around whoever's in at quarterback, but this offense has come and gone with what Justin Fields has been able to do, both throwing the ball, running the ball. Especially we saw last game him run a little bit more than he had in the past. So yeah, that would be a potential a stumbling block for Ohio State if Justin Fields were to get injured and miss any significant time. He said this week he's doing fine. His back was sore after the game, but it didn't sound like it was anything more than, you know, kind of bumps and bruises of a physical Big Ten game between two top 15 teams. Obviously, you don't want to see him get hit and land on the back like that, but he promised he's not going to miss any reps this week. He's going to continue to improve and work on his fundamentals, which is what he did over the last off week. So it sounds like business as usual for Justin Fields. Nothing really to worry about for Ohio State fans when it comes to that back injury.
Yeah, and of course, the emergence of Justin Fields and just his presence in the running game has opened things up for J.K. Dobbins to really explode and have just a tremendous season. And it's been the combination of improved offensive line play from a run-blocking standpoint, Fields' presence, but also J.K. committing himself to becoming an elite player, and he certainly has this year. All-time Ohio State battling Oklahoma and Notre Dame for Heisman trophies. Maybe they could send one to Columbus or maybe three to Columbus with Fields, Chase Young, and J.K., but they seem to be prominent in the race as this team continues to dominate, and they post the performances that they do. Of course, for Chase Young, it's a bit of a different animal. It's based on just you got to watch the games. You got to watch the dominance and understand what the attention that he gets.
Right.
Not all going to be displayed on the stat sheet, just your thoughts about where the Heisman race lands and where it could go and what Chase Young could possibly do to get himself in serious running for this thing.
It's interesting because obviously the only defensive player to win the Heisman Trophy was also a special teams guy and was able to score touchdowns that way. And Ryan Day was actually asked this week, do you consider putting Chase in on, you know, as a tight end or a fullback or something to get him a touchdown and maybe boost his chances for the Heisman? And he said, you know, they're not going to risk injury just to get Chase Young a touchdown. So he's going to have to do it on the defensive side of the ball. And, you know, he's the only player in the country with a sack in every game. He's, you know, probably going to set he should set Ohio State's single season sack record next week. He's half a sack behind in that category. And he just needs to continue to be dominant. You know, the Wisconsin game was a chance for him to showcase himself at a national spotlight. These next few weeks, obviously Ohio State's off this week, but then Maryland and Rutgers, not going to be a lot of eyeballs on those games, I imagine. But if his statistics are eye-popping enough that, you know, it attracts attention, that'll build that momentum going into the last two games of the season, Penn State and Michigan, which obviously people will be tuning into. So in my mind, I think it's a long shot. I think there's too many offensive players that are having good years. Justin Fields, J.K. Dobbins on Ohio State, but Tua Tagovailoa, if he can get back healthy for Alabama, Joe Burrow at LSU, Justin Herbert is quietly putting together a very good season at Oregon that he's kind of been forgotten about. You know, there's a number of guys that I think are in the running offensively, and you know, it's just so tough for a defensive guy. I mean, the award is supposed to be the best player in college football, but I think we can all admit that it hasn't been for a long time. It's, you know, was an offensive player award, and now it's almost become a quarterback award. So, you know, J.K. Dobbins, I think, is certainly in there, second in the country in rushing. The knock against him for Heisman Trophy and national awards are he doesn't have a ton of touchdowns, only 9 rushing touchdowns on the season. And that's just because Ohio State has so many weapons. You know, Justin Fields is throwing the ball a lot. He's taking some of those rushing touchdowns. You know, the receivers are scoring. So he may not end up with the touchdown statistics that, as some of the other running backs in the country. But if Ohio State in those two final games continues to play like they did against Wisconsin and their stars really show up, it's going to be hard to at least not have one of those guys, if not maybe two, which we haven't seen in quite a while, in New York for at least the ceremony come December.
We got Patrick Murphy on the line from Bucknuts 247 Sports. Please join him and the rest of the crew there in covering Ohio State football as well as anyone around. The Buckeyes with a bye week, coming off the huge win over Wisconsin 38-7. Maryland, Rutgers, Penn State, Michigan. And speaking of Michigan, is anybody taking account of what the Wolverines have produced, I'll say, in the last game and a half?
Yeah.
They got down 21-0 against Penn State. And I give that team a whole lot of credit because of facing the whiteout, the road conditions, Penn State dominating, and the narrative that they've got to just have weighing on their shoulders. Okay, it's 21-0. Here we go again. And they fought back and came within a dropped pass in the end zone of tying that game. And then they turn around after that major letdown and disappointment, thinking, okay, we played this well, but we still blew it, to turn around and dominate a Notre Dame team by 31 points. Michigan can't really play for anything tangibly for a championship by all reasonable measures. but they seem to have put some things together.
Absolutely. And I think when you look at this team, you know, going back before that Penn State game, the question was, you know, are they going to quit, you know, on this season? If it goes poorly in Happy Valley, and as you mentioned, the whiteout at night, you know, did they just kind of give up and roll up in a ball and, you know, call it a day? And they didn't, you know, even going down big against Penn State, they fight back. You know, and then obviously, like you mentioned, the blowout of a top 10 team in Notre Dame at a night game at the Big House. I think you just saw a lot of fight from this team. And that's, you know, from a Michigan perspective, good to see. And even from an Ohio State perspective, I think you know, I've always been the believer that you want that game to mean something at the end of the season. And it means something to Ohio State fans and Michigan fans, no matter what. But to have a nationally relevant game, you know, just like we were talking about earlier with the Heisman stuff, you know, you want more eyeballs on this team, just, you know, to make sure that you know, they're going to get in the playoff if they're undefeated and whatnot. And I think they will. I don't even have to worry about that. But it's always better to have a high-profile game. And if Michigan can keep performing like they have in the last game and a half, it could be a top 10 matchup towards the end of the season or close to it, assuming Ohio State handles its business as well. So, yeah, I've been impressed with Michigan. The Notre Dame game, I thought they might win that game just because it's at home and they showed well in the second half against Penn State. I didn't think they would control it like that. Notre Dame knew they were going to run the ball. Michigan hasn't run the ball very well, and they just ran it down their throats. Notre Dame couldn't run the ball in terrible conditions weather-wise. And, you know, it was the best Michigan game I've seen in you know, a while now. And you know, just impressive for them. And I'll be interested to see how they continue, you know, as they go into these next few weeks. Obviously not the marquee games in all of those as the Penn State and Notre Dame game was. So how do you keep up that intensity and make sure you don't let another one slip away? That'll be interesting. But, you know, it could be headed, like I said, to a very, very exciting Ohio State-Michigan game in Ann Arbor at the end of November.